Recorded Books and One Click Digital present Her Little Majesty, The Life of Queen Victoria by Carolee Erickson, narrated by Nelson Runger.
Chapter 1. The king, seated in his elegant painted phaeton, the reins of his fine team of matched horses held in his pudgy, beringed hands, looked out over the gardens of Windsor Great Park and was content. The sun was sparkling on the blue waters of the lake, the mingled scents of roses and honeysuckle and wisteria filled the air, and in the distance the royal band was playing a lilting operatic air. All was in readiness for the afternoon's entertainment. A royal fishing party, with many of the king's relatives, his courtiers, his circle of friends and admirers in attendance. The year was 1826, and George IV, in his 64th year, was rapidly aging. He was weak in the knees, his eyesight was going. He had to take laudanum, which made him bilious, to ease the severe pain of a bladder complaint, and a lifetime of gorging himself on rich French food and potent liqueurs had made him so hugely fat that it took his dressers hours to stuff him into his corsets and sew him into his plum-colored silk jackets and enormously wide white pantaloons. His sallow, bulging cheeks had to be smeared with rouge, his full lips artificially reddened, and his sparse gray hair covered with a dark wig to disguise his senescence. And even then, court gossips whispered to one another about his obvious decline. Before long, they said, he would suffer the fate of his father, George III, who had taken complete leave of his senses and died a feeble lunatic, his mind ravaged by delusions. That he might indeed go mad was a thought never far from King George's mind, even on the sunniest of days, devoted as most of his days were to pleasure. And any reminder of his increasing incapacity, either mental or physical, filled him with dread. For he would one day die, and then his throne, his wealth, and all that he had spent a lifetime accumulating would pass not to a child of his own body, but to his greedy, ungrateful, unworthy brothers. To Frederick, his oldest brother, handsome but stupid, and quite possibly, since Frederick had no children, to his second brother William, farcical and grotesque, the family joke and disgrace. And then, as William was elderly and childless, to the king's little niece, Alexandrina Victoria. King George had had his eye on his young niece for some time. She was the only child of his late brother Edward, Duke of Kent, an odious man, the king thought, debt-ridden, brutish, a boor in society, a bully in the family. Edward was no loss. But his child, now 7 years old and living with her mother in a set of shabby apartments in Kensington Palace, was worthy of her royal uncle's attention. For one thing, she was unique, the only living legitimate grandchild of George III. There had been others, most notably King George IV's daughter Charlotte, but they had all died young. If the king and his siblings continued to be childless, Alexandrina Victoria would one day be queen. For another thing, George's advisors and spies assured him that she was a sturdy, healthy child, with good, strong Hanoverian blood, and that the vicious rumors about her, rumors that spoke of ill health, weak limbs, and diseased feet, were unfounded. Then there was the possibility that the king might outlive both Frederick and William, and that the crown might pass directly to the young princess on George's death. In that event, the king thought, he would like to have the chance to mold his successor himself. He had been thinking of bringing Alexandrina Victoria to live with him, so that he could begin to shape her tastes and design her education. His prime minister, the Duke of Wellington, had advised against it. and this was causing the king to think twice about his plan. But he had decided to invite the princess, along with her mother and half-sister, to visit Windsor so that he could see her for himself. She would attend the fishing party this afternoon, in fact. Entertaining her would be one of the many pleasures he anticipated, to distract him from the gathering pains in his body and the annoying paperwork that had been accumulating on his desk for many months. The nuisance of government, he decided, he would leave to Wellington. He had enough to worry about, without letting the everyday work of ruling burden him too. As the king drove his phaeton along the path by the lake, passing the Chinese pagoda and the tents erected on the grass for the buffet, a pony cart was approaching from the opposite direction. A small vehicle with rock-hard seats and no springs, its cramped passengers jostling uncomfortably against each other with every bump and dip in the uneven surface of the road. In the cart were the princess, a plump, ringleted, rather plain child who looked to be no more than 5 or 6 years old, her blooming, pink-cheeked half-sister, Theodore, who was 18 and bewitchingly pretty, the princess's middle-aged governess, Louise Letson, and the Duchess of Kent, mother of both girls, and by far the most prepossessing figure of the four. The Kent party had been invited to stay at Cumberland Lodge by the king himself, and this mark of his favor was as welcome to the Duchess as it was unexpected. Until very recently, George IV had been no friend to the Duchess or her children. Indeed, he had gone out of his way to demonstrate not only coldness, but outright hostility to the family of his late brother Edward. When the young princess was born, the king, who was not on speaking terms with her father, behaved ungraciously at her christening and refused to allow her to be named Georgiana after him or Charlotte after his daughter. And when, 8 months later, Edward of Kent was on his deathbed, his royal brother didn't come to see him, but only sent a curt message of anxious solicitude. King George had never shown the slightest concern for the financial well-being of his widowed sister-in-law, even though she had been in a near desperate state and only the timely generosity of her brother Leopold had saved her from ruin and her children from want. In fact, until very recently, King George had let it be known that he wanted the Kents to leave England and go to live in obscurity among the Duchess's German relatives. But in the last few months, there had been signs that he was having a change of heart. He had written to the Duchess about her older daughter Theodore, her child by her first husband, Prince Amick Charles of Leiningen, and had made frequent private inquiries about Alexandrina Victoria. Now he was entertaining the family at Windsor, inviting them to dine with him and his many other guests at the Royal Lodge, where the food was ambrosial and the plate solid gold. Clearly, things were changing, and the change was making the Duchess nervous. As she reached her 40th year, Victoire, Duchess of Kent, was still an uncommonly handsome woman, with chestnut hair, wide brown eyes, and a fine high forehead. She carried her head proudly on a long, graceful neck, and she dressed to emphasize her importance as mother to the child third in line for the throne in deep dark velvets, ropes of pearls, and very large, wide-brimmed hats with sweeping ostrich plumes. No one who saw the Duchess ever forgot her, though cruel observers said behind her back that her conversation was insipid and her intellect mediocre. She knew that nearly all her royal in-laws were contemptuous of her, with the exception of her sister-in-law Adelaide, William's wife, who was a font of genuine kindness and Christian forbearance, and her sister-in-law Sophia, King George's youngest sister, who was unstable but friendly and who occupied apartments adjoining those of the Kents in Kensington Palace. The Duchess was in no doubt that the King's invitation to join his pleasure party was only incidentally extended to her. No, it was Fyodor and Alexandrina Victoria he wanted to see. But why, exactly? Could he possibly have his eye on Fyodor as a prospective bride? A fresh young girl who could give him an heir? And could he be planning to take the little Alexandrina Victoria away from her in order to counteract the Duchess's influence over her and ensure that if the young princess should come to the throne while still a child, someone other than her mother would be appointed as regent for her until she reached her majority? The child herself, caught up in admiring the beauty of the gardens and the splendor of her surroundings, took scant heed of her mother's misgivings. There was so much to marvel at. The gazelles and goats kept in their special enclosure, the gorgeous rooms at Cumberland Lodge, each with its own character, decorated with carved, polished furniture and sofas upholstered in rich brocade and deep-piled carpets, the cream cakes served on fragile painted china, so thin it was almost translucent, the King's grooms in their scarlet and blue liveries, the King himself, like a huge waddling doll, painted and gilded, fragrant with scent and oily with unguents, who talked to her in a friendly way and gave her a diamond pin with his own portrait in miniature. Alexandrina Victoria decided that she liked her Uncle King, as her mother said she must call him. Not as well as she liked her Uncle Leopold, who was like a father to her, or her Uncle Frederick, the tall, shy old soldier who had always been kind to her and gave her lovely presents, including the donkey she loved to ride with Fyodor walking along on one side and her nurse on the other. But far better than her Uncle Sussex, the towering giant of whom she was terrified, or Uncle Cumberland, whose horribly scarred face and malevolent expression sent her running to Letson. The little girl didn't yet understand why this visit to Windsor to see Uncle King was so important, why her mother was more than usually ill at ease, or why Letson, ever anxious, was tight-faced with strain. She didn't know her own significance in the succession. She only knew that, for a few days at least, she was being allowed a glimpse of a wider, more comfortable, and happier life than the one she led at Kensington Palace, where all seemed cramped, dingy, and miserable, and where she was often very lonely and sad. The King, in his phaeton, came up to the pony cart, and both vehicles stopped. The King leaned down and addressed the Kents. "Pop her in," he said, meaning Alexandrina Victoria. The Duchess hesitated, evidently fearful, then allowed her daughter to be handed across into the phaeton. The King's sister, Mary, who was sitting beside him, grabbed the child around the waist and put her on the seat. The King flipped his whip, and the phaeton moved on. Many years later, Alexandrina Victoria recalled that afternoon as one of the happiest of her childhood. The ride with His Majesty, the music floating out over the lake, the crowd of beautifully dressed people gathered at the fishing temple to indulge in the idle sport of fishing for carp, the King's constant attention to herself and her pretty sister, all were to stand out in her memory as part of an enchanted idyll. She was to remember in particular King George's grave and regal charm, the way he won her over by bending down and addressing her as if she were quite grown up, asking her what tune she would like the band to play. For weeks afterward, she enjoyed the happy afterglow of her time with her Uncle King, never suspecting that he, soon bored with the elaborate fishing party, and more than a little disappointed with his homely young niece, who reminded him disturbingly of her hated father, had soon stopped thinking of her at all and let his thoughts drift to his indigestion, his annoyance with his valets, and a mare he had running at Newmarket. It must have seemed to Drina that she had always lived in the sprawling old brick mansion known as Kensington Palace. She had no memory of any other house, having been far too young to remember the seaside cottage at Sidmouth where the family had been living in 1820 when her father died. Kensington was her home. Its overgrown formal gardens, long straight paths and clipped hedges her playground. Its tall old trees and time-blackened statues cracked and chipped, as familiar to her as the face of her governess, Letson. With Mrs. Brock, her nurse, or one of the palace footmen trailing behind her, she wandered along the endless dim corridors and huge echoing rooms of the dilapidated house, rooms largely bare of furnishings as the palace had not been lived in by a reigning monarch for well over a century and had fallen into neglect. Everywhere the princess looked, she saw evidence of decay. In the stagnant, silent fountains that no longer ran, the frayed, faded hangings that clung to the walls, the broken locks on doors hanging crooked on their hinges. The floors creaked. There were water stains on the once pristine plasterwork ceilings, and even the portraits on the walls, portraits of men and women in the quaint stiff gowns, ruffs, and square hats of another era, were indistinct and dark with age. No one told Drina that she was a poor relation of the royal family, living on sufferance in a tumble-down house, but as she grew older, she must have come to understand that this was so. Years later, she recalled how, as a child, she never had a room to herself, nor a sofa, nor an easy chair. How all the carpets in the rooms she and her mother lived in were threadbare, and how her mother was forever preoccupied with expenses and bankers and debt. Having seen Windsor Castle when she was 7, and having spent time at her Uncle Leopold's comfortable house, Claremont, she had had a taste of luxury, and knew that Kensington represented its opposite. And she must have realized, too, as she grew older, that the constant tension and conflict in the household went along with the want of money and comfort, that her mother's highly variable moods, her irascible temper, resulted in part from her financial uncertainties and the expedients she was forced to employ to relieve them. The Duchess was deeply in debt, and each year her debts mounted higher. Her husband's estate was insolvent, and although by 1826 she had a parliamentary grant of £6,000 a year to live on, plus an additional £3,000 from her brother Leopold, these sums were barely sufficient to pay the interest on her debts, much less provide the furnishings of an aristocratic household and pay for its upkeep. The Duchess felt deprived and aggrieved. Other members of the royal family received much larger parliamentary grants than she did. Her brother Leopold, for example, a widower who had at one time been married to King George IV's daughter Charlotte, was grandly recommended at £50,000 a year. Economy was essential. But the Duchess could not cut back on her expenses. She had to keep up appearances, to pay servants and tutors for the princess, and dressmakers and milliners and purveyors of food and drink. Meanwhile, the bankers kept demanding more, and the Duchess had no means of raising more cash to pay them. She possessed only one thing of real value, young Drina's birthright. One day, before long, Drina would be queen, with riches unimaginable, and she, the Duchess, would be regent. Then all debts could be paid, and there would be such an abundance of wealth left over that she couldn't possibly spend it, not if she tried for a lifetime. On the strength of these hopeful expectations, the Duchess applied for more loans. But the bankers insisted that she supply more substantive collateral than her daughter's expectations. There had to be land, houses, concrete valuables to back the debts. Because of this, the Duchess was drawn into an unholy bargain, one she lived to regret in time. In charge of her finances, as controller of her household, was an ambitious, good-looking, extremely hard-working Anglo-Irishman named John Conroy. Conroy had entered the military as a young man in the early years of the century, and had soon shown outstanding ability with horses and money. Able to judge the one and attract, juggle, and manipulate the other. These talents brought him to the attention of the Duke of Kent, who was perpetually short of money and who needed a steady supply of horses for his large stable. The Duke made Conroy his equerry and came to rely on him as a friend. On his deathbed, the Duke entrusted the well-being of his wife and baby daughter to his equerry, a fact of which Conroy reminded the Duchess again and again. Captain Conroy offered to put up his own property and possessions to guarantee the Duchess's loans, and was more than willing to help her secure them. For Conroy intended to share in the wealth that would one day be showered on Princess Drina and her mother, and the Duchess acquiesced in his ambitions. A bargain was sealed between them that if Conroy would continue to pledge his collateral and to handle the Duchess's finances in such a way as to keep her creditors at bay, she would repay him once her daughter ascended the throne. Their bargain may or may not have had an erotic dimension. Wellington thought it had. But it locked the Duchess and her financial partner in a stormy intimacy marked by frequent quarrels. Both sought power and wealth through influence over the princess. Each sought to gain the upper hand over the other. Factions formed, with Conroy winning to his side, among others, the Duchess's son and oldest child, Charles, who had inherited the Principality of Leiningen, but came to live in England in 1824. The disputes and disagreements swirled around Drina, clouding her childhood and making her hate Conroy more and more as it became apparent that he was winning the battle for control. The Duchess, whether ultimately convinced of the superior wisdom of her financial partner or simply beaten down by his alternate bullying and cajoling, gave way. By the time Drina was 8 or 9 years old, Conroy was firmly in command, making all decisions, both financial and personal, for the household. Conroy ruled with an iron hand. Though his orders were delivered by the Duchess, who was nominally in charge, in actuality he dictated all. Or so Charles of Leiningen told a confidant much later, looking back over the dark years at Kensington Palace. Conroy had a talent beyond those of judging horseflesh and handling money. He knew how to handle and manipulate women, and attain a degree of control over susceptible ones, a control that had something sordid about it. Indeed, Conroy was a shady character. Not merely an opportunist, but a fraud, an exploiter, a weaver of fictions. The Duchess of Kent believed his fictions, as did the eccentric, mentally wayward Princess Sophia, who was also drawn in by him and supplied him with information about her brother the King and the other royals. Sophia turned her ample resources over to Conroy to manage, and even put him in her will. In the year that the Kents visited Windsor, 1826, Conroy came into possession of an estate worth £18,000, a gift from Princess Sophia. Drina, Theodore, the Duchess, all the servants, everyone was governed by Conroy's rules, which were intended to keep the princess in a safe, stifling cocoon until her accession. She was never to be left alone, without supervision. She was to be kept in isolation from other children, except Conroy's children. She was to be kept away as much as possible from her disreputable royal relatives, those uncles around whom scandal gathered. And she was not to leave the palace grounds except on carefully chaperoned excursions to the theater. If she showed affection or partiality to a servant, the servant must be dismissed. And if the princess misbehaved, as she very often did, she was to be put out on the landing with her hands tied behind her back until she became contrite. Misery descended on the Duchess of Kent's apartments. Drina was watched, hovered over, protected, all but smothered. From the time she arose in the morning until she got into her small French bed at night in her mother's room, the princess was kept under the strictest control, and everything she said and did was reported to Conroy. No word she spoke, no sneeze, no choice of hair ribbon, no detail of her instruction escaped his scrutiny. When she went up and down stairs, someone was nearby to hold her hand lest she trip and fall. When she walked through a room or along a garden path, a footman in gold and green followed close behind her. When she sat down to eat, the food set before her was tasted by someone else to be sure it contained no poison, a precaution taken to satisfy the Duchess, who feared that Drina's Uncle Ernest would stop at nothing, not even murder, to remove her from the succession. Treated like a fragile, precious piece of carved glass or china, instead of like the sturdy, feisty child she was, Drina suffered and smoldered with pent-up fury. "I had led a very unhappy life as a child," she told her own daughter as she reached middle age. "I had no scope for my very violent feelings of affection, had no brothers and sisters to live with, never had a father, from my unfortunate circumstances was not on a comfortable or at all intimate or confidential footing with my mother, and didn't know what a happy domestic life was. I was extremely crushed," she remembered on another occasion, "and kept under and hardly dared say a word." Drina's half-sister Feodor, too, was hobbled and suppressed by the restricting rules. Because she was so much older than her sister, the closeness between the two was not like that of siblings. It had more the character of parent and child. Drina adored Feodor, but was often kept away from her. Feodor loved Drina, but was jealous of her, and believed that the Duchess loved her younger daughter more. She didn't accept her mother's wan assurances that she loved both of her daughters equally. When, as a mature woman, Feodor looked back on her years at Kensington Palace, she wrote of them as years of trial, and thanked God that they were over. In a letter to Drina, she remembered with some bitterness how she had been deprived of the pleasures of youth, immured like a nun, and prevented from forming friendships or meeting anyone. Even the innocent satisfactions of conversation were denied her. Not one cheerful thought in that dismal existence of ours was very hard, she wrote. My only happy time was going or driving out with you and Letson. Then I could speak or look as I liked. Feodor's life, though curtailed, was not in fact devoid of adventure or romance. The other royal occupant of Kensington Palace, besides Drina and Princess Sophia, was Augustus, Duke of Sussex, and he had a son and namesake, a cavalry officer, who glimpsed Feodor and fell in love with her when he was in his early 20s and she 17. The young officer soon discovered that he could not gain access to Feodor. Conroy permitted no visitors. But one of the Duchess's attendants, Baroness Speight, an old woman who had been in service with the family for decades and was utterly devoted to both Feodor and Drina, agreed to take young Augustus's messages to Feodor and deliver them in secret. A clandestine correspondence began. no doubt as exciting to Fyodor as it was encouraging to the eager officer. When he became more serious, however, and sent Fyodor 2 gold rings via the Baroness, Fyodor could not bring herself to accept them, or to give Augustus a promise of marriage. Even though she was desperate to escape, and confided to Drina when both were adults that she would have married almost anyone if it meant release from Kensington Palace, she panicked and confessed her secret to her mother. As she might have expected, the Duchess was furious, not only because she had no intention of letting her pretty daughter marry a non-entity with no social standing and no money, but because Fyodor had proven that the security of the household could be breached. Also, the Duchess had to tell Conroy what had happened and face his wrath. In the end, Fyodor was given a harsh lecture. The Duke of Sussex was put in his place and told to keep his son in check, and the lovelorn cavalry officer felt the full brunt of his father's anger. Conroy was resentful toward Baroness Spate and determined to marry Fyodor off to the first presentable candidate for her hand, to prevent her from causing any more disruption. If Fyodor's reaction to her repressive environment was to welcome clandestine adventure, Drina's was, in her earliest years, to rebel. As a very young child, she had screamed with fury, pounding her fists and shouting herself hoarse whenever Mrs. Brock or Letson tried to correct her or discipline her. Once she angrily threw a pair of scissors at Letson, who often remarked that she had never known a child as passionate and naughty as Drina. She refused to learn her alphabet, threw fits when made to wash or have her hair brushed or dress in the stiff, uncomfortable layers of linen, lace, and velvet her mother insisted on. Storms of tears broke over the nursery every day, many times a day. And when the storms subsided, Drina was left comfortless. Amid the tensions, conflicts, and festering resentments of Kensington Palace, an emotional forcing house, if ever there was one, Drina's young character took form. Shy, nervous, ill at ease beneath her passionate surface, the little girl struggled to find her place. "I was always taught to consider myself a soldier's child," she later remarked. And indeed, she became inwardly a little soldier, toughening herself against the hard knocks of fate, standing her ground firmly and stubbornly in the face of enemy attack, loyal to her allies and implacably opposed to her enemies. And given to categorize anyone she encountered as either friend or foe. She adopted a soldier's simple, straightforward code of honor. She never lied, though she often concealed the truth of her feelings. She never abandoned her friends. She never retreated. She sought victory through stolid endurance and respected those who did the same. She stood at her post, uncomplaining, for as long as she possibly could. She hated deceit and intrigue. These constituted betrayal and invited defeat. She distrusted subtlety, flights of intellect, obfuscation. Dilemmas, crises of conscience she would always minimize, believing firmly that right-mindedness would dissolve all apparent contradictions in human affairs. Thus embattled, the round, stout, fair child who was third in line for the British throne girded herself to face the challenges that lay ahead for her, her blue eyes often sad but always observant, her small mouth often agape, her mind determined at whatever cost to meet and overcome disaster. Chapter 2. In the fall of 1829, when the princess was 10 years old, Conroy ordered sweeping changes in the Duchess of Kent's household. Old Baroness Spate, who had served the Duchess for 25 years, was told to leave, And Louise Letson, too, was made to understand that her services were no longer wanted. Speight and Letson belonged to the Duchess's German past. Speight spoke English very badly. But the Duchess was becoming an Englishwoman now, and needed to surround herself and the Princess with English servants. She was rising in the world. Her status had advanced, for the Princess's Uncle Frederick had died, and Drina was now heir presumptive, second in line for the throne. To mark her newfound importance, the Duchess began to give grand dinners in her rundown rooms, inviting not only Princess Sophia and the Duke of Sussex, but other members of the extensive royal family, along with nobles and ambassadors. The expense of feeding 20 to 25 guests, plus the hiring of chefs, waiters, and extra servants, strained the Duchess's already overstrained credit. And there were additional dressmakers and milliners' bills as well. But as always, Conroy made all possible. Indeed, he encouraged the giving of more such entertainments, at which the Duchess, dowdy but animated, presided with a happily self-important air. The Princess appeared before the guests, scrubbed and polished until she shone, her darkening blonde hair curled charmingly around her face, dressed in the stiff organdy gowns, wide satin sashes, and lace-trimmed pantalettes then in fashion for girls. The guests couldn't help noticing how short she was for a child of 10, but she held herself well. Her mother trained her to hold up her head by pinning holly under her chin so that if her head drooped, the sharp thorns pricked her neck. Her good manners were noted and approved, and she was able, if called upon, to recite French and German poetry and to sit down at the pianoforte and play There's No Place Like Home or The Battle of Prague to polite applause. She sang duets with her mother, who had a good ear for music and composed songs. The princess's voice, high, clear, and true, lacked richness and warmth of tone, but was pleasingly sweet. The princess, who was no longer called Drina but Victoria, the more dignified name thought to be more appropriate to her higher status, was indirectly responsible for the upheaval in the household. She saw something she shouldn't have seen. A touch, an embrace, a conspiratorial whisper with an erotic promise hinted at, between her mother and Conroy, and she confided it to Speight. The latter, who had been in Conroy's bad graces for several years, chastised her mistress, the Duchess, and was ordered out of the palace. Victoria was very fond of the elderly, ugly Baroness Speight, and her departure must have been a hard blow to the princess, and a cause of increased resentment against the all-powerful Conroy. Speight had spoiled Victoria to the point of idolatry. Kneeling before her, looking fondly on while she covered cardboard boxes with tinsel or rode her pony or learned her lessons. Speight was one of a group of grandmotherly figures who had been in the background of Victoria's life since her birth. They included her baby nurse, Mrs. Brock, not a pleasant person, Victoria recalled as an adult, Mrs. Lewis, whom Victoria called Good Lewis and who lived at Claremont, Uncle Leopold's estate, and Princess Amelia Carolath, a relative of Aunt Adelaide's whom Victoria knew well as a young child. Mrs. Lewis, Amelia Carolath, and Speight adored, petted, and caressed the young princess, Speight most of all. Their smiles and nods of approval may have helped to counteract the unpredictable, irritable Duchess of Kent, whose moods were so variable and who was touchy and jealous. Speight's departure followed closely on another major turning point in Victoria's emotional life. In 1828, her sister Theodore had married Prince Ernest of Hohenlohe-Langenburg, a handsome if impecunious German nobleman, and had left England for faraway Schloss Langenburg. Although Fyodor continued to write regularly, her little sister missed her terribly. Without Fyodor, or Baroness Speight, Victoria turned more and more to Lettson as not only a governess, but a surrogate mother. But Lettson was a complex character, who, as Victoria realized later, had not much softness, and whose marked intelligence was devoted at times to mischief and intrigue. Lettson was much more circumspect than Speight had been. She knew how to hold her tongue and keep her position, and in fact she didn't follow Speight into exile on the continent. Though she must have been fully aware of all the machinations in the palace, she didn't complain about them, or draw Conroy's wrath or injure the Duchess's pride. She did, however, contrive to win the princess's loyalty and confided in her, making her keep secrets from her mother. Lettson was also at times quite stern with Victoria, who feared as well as loved her. If Conroy governed the household, Lettson meant to govern at least her own small part of it, and that the most important part, the heart of the princess. By the age of 10, Victoria was spending 4 hours a day at her lessons, though she was not a particularly apt student and disliked learning. The urge to rebel that had made her resist memorizing the alphabet until she was 5 now made her a difficult student to manage. She was not trained to become a ruler, apart from learning to speak French and German and absorbing a smattering of history and geography, there was nothing in her education to set her apart from any other high-born girl. Accomplishments, not intellectual training or a wide breadth of knowledge, were the goal. The Duchess and Conroy wanted Victoria to become an ornament to the drawing room, able to recite, sing, and play, to dance a quadrille, and to draw for her own amusement. A variety of tutors provided instruction besides Lettson. A French dancing mistress, a German pastor, an Anglican clergyman who tried often unsuccessfully to teach his pupil ancient history and the rudiments of Latin, and made her read what she later recalled as many dull books. Victoria liked arithmetic and thought she had a talent for it. She loved dancing, enjoyed her piano and singing lessons, and always looked forward to the arrival of her drawing master, the academician Richard Westall. Drawing was the princess's only conspicuous talent, and under Westall's indulgent and patient tutelage, her talent began to expand. She copied the sketches he made for her. She sketched from memory stage performers she had seen, her pets, and the people in her household. At the age of 11, she undertook, all on her own, to copy a Thomas Lawrence portrait, though how true a copy it was can only be conjectured. Victoria's Uncle Leopold, the sanest and most disinterested of her relations, might have guided her education quite differently had he been in charge of it, for he had foresight and considerable political sophistication. He believed that his niece would one day rule England, and even if, like everyone else, he expected her to rule through trusted male advisors and not to make her own decisions, still, he recognized how important it was that she be well informed and able to think clearly and with discrimination. But as Victoria reached her 10th year, Leopold was distracted by other concerns. An able man, mature and worldly, popular with the English, though not with King George, who called him Monsieur Peu à Peu and thought him ridiculously cautious and deliberate, Leopold was respected abroad. When in 1829 the Greeks won independence from the Turkish Empire, Leopold was invited to become king of Greece. He wanted to accept, but declined with regret after months of negotiations at the insistence of King George and his ministers. Soon afterward, however, a better situation presented itself. The Belgians rebelled against the King of Holland and eventually, with the blessing of the British government, asked Leopold to become their ruler. He accepted gladly and prepared to move to Brussels, where his new responsibilities absorbed him and left him little time to spare for Victoria. He wrote to her and kept himself informed of events in England, but his new preoccupations allowed the conniving Conroy to work against him and advance his own interests still further. The glittering prize of a regency continued to draw Conroy and the Duchess like a magnet. And all Conroy had to do to alarm the latter was to suggest that she might never achieve the prize she sought. Now he told her that her brother Leopold, having won the crown of Belgium, was scheming in secret to become regent for the princess. So bold was the new king's plan that he had actually drawn up legal papers establishing his authority in the event the princess became queen before she reached the age of 18, Conroy said. And the Duchess believed him. Leopold's influence with his sister, already in decline, reached a new low. Between struggling through her lessons and displaying her accomplishments, Victoria enjoyed a closely supervised leisure. She played with her favorite dog, Fanny, collected seashells, wrote letters to Theodore and Uncle Leopold, and read illustrated annuals bound in watered silk that showed her an idealized, sentimentalized world filled with simpering, retiring women, bold, dashing men, and antique houses dwarfed by towering mountains and vast expanses of heath. She admired her mother's copies of La Belle Assemblée, a woman's periodical combining pictures of dainty Paris gowns with stories of tempestuous love, blood-curdling crime, and daring adventure. Her slightly protuberant blue eyes widened at the pictures of menacing phantoms and howling savages. Her strong little heart pounded when she read of maidens rescued from fates unspeakable and unnatural beings stalking human prey. She lay at night in her chintz-curtained bed, knowing that her mother was asleep in her own bed just across the room, and listened to the constant ticking of her father's old tortoiseshell watch, kept in the watch pocket on her mother's bedstead. Its ticking, the gauge that marked the passing hours of her childhood. Day by day, she enfolded herself in a special fantasy world. She made dolls. Taking small ceramic figures, 5 or 6 inches high, Victoria and Letson dressed them in tiny silk and velvet gowns with minute lace aprons and feathered hats and linen pantalettes. These miniature ladies all had names and characters invented by the princess and lived imaginary lives. Their husbands, their children, their aristocratic titles and country houses were all spelled out in detail. Many of the dolls were dressed as ballet dancers, for Victoria was enchanted with the ballet, and others were dressed like actors and opera singers in favorite roles. The making of the dolls reinforced the growing bond between Victoria and Letson. The German governess, who was so conscientious and loyal that she never took time for herself, not one day or even one afternoon off, sat with Victoria by the hour and cut and stitched and glued the bits of braid and satin ribbon that adorned her dolls. She entered Victoria's fantasies and shared them, earning the child's undying trust and affection. Had Victoria not been a royal child, she would have had playmates with whom to make and enjoy her dozens of dolls. But she was not allowed playmates, other than Conroy's daughter Victoire, named for the Duchess of Kent, who was a companion forced upon her and deeply resented. Little is known about Victoire Conroy, and as she was the closest thing the princess had to a sibling her own age, the void in the historical record is to be regretted. Of the two, Victoire was the elder, though not by much. She was almost certainly bigger and taller, and she was much prettier, with dark hair and hazel eyes and small, regular features. Victoria was by nature affectionate, and she was certainly lonely. Had Conroy's daughter been warm and friendly, the princess would probably have become fond of her. But no fondness developed, only dislike and distrust. Perhaps no daughter of the man Victoria hated as her jailer and persecutor could have surmounted her inherent wariness and resentment. Or perhaps Victoire was not a likable child. Certainly the princess came to believe that Conroy used Victoire against her, instructing Victoire to tell tales about her royal playmate's babyish ways and fragile health and difficulties in learning her lessons. It must have been a particularly unpleasant form of torment for Victoria, being thrown together constantly with another child for whom she felt only detestation, never being allowed to refuse the detested one's company, having to coexist on strained terms, always watched, her doings and sayings always repeated. The unwelcome presence of the Conroy children must have been especially galling to Victoria at Christmas time, when following the German custom, pine trees in pots were set out on long tables, the trees decorated with colored wax candles in blue, green, red, and white, the tables heaped with gifts. Toys for the children, gloves, pocket handkerchiefs, books, work boxes, jewelry, and other mementos for the adults. Having to share her holiday with Conroy and his brood, especially Victoire, can only have been a bitter reminder to Victoria of her awkward, painful situation. With no father, a distant and often irascible mother, and a haughty, self-important martinet at the head of everything. Conroy was more insufferable than ever, having been made a knight, and thus Sir John Conroy. His knighthood was not very distinguished. He was a mere knight commander of the Hanoverian order, a title Princess Sophia procured for him from her ailing brother King George. But his hauteur was as great as if he had been made a royal duke. In the spring of 1830, as Victoria approached her 11th birthday and the aged, fatally ill king struggled to hold on to life, Conroy and the Duchess of Kent both held themselves very high, according to the mordantly observant Princess Leven, wife of the Russian ambassador, as if the throne were to be theirs tomorrow. Bursting with self-importance, Conroy strode about in his dress uniform, reacting irritably to any perceived slight, exploding into wrath at any thwarting of his designs. He and the Duchess were both waiting eagerly for word from the palace that the king was dead. And when the long-expected news finally arrived at the end of June 1830, they sprang into action. A letter was carried to the Prime Minister, signed by the Duchess of Kent but composed by Conroy, asserting Victoria's rights as heir apparent. She needed a larger staff, more suitable quarters, a more generous allowance, the letter said. The Duchess herself needed a larger income, in keeping with her role as Dowager Princess of Wales, the late Duke of Kent being posthumously promoted to Prince of Wales. And she insisted in language that was bound to cause friction by its arrogance that she be made regent for her daughter. It was a needlessly combative beginning to the new reign, one that put Victoria in an awkward position. The new monarch and his wife, King William IV and Queen Adelaide, had always shown kindness and benevolence toward Victoria. And now, when Adelaide came to visit her at Kensington Palace, she discovered that she had to wait for admittance. The Duchess had given orders that all visitors, even the Queen, had to be formally announced before being allowed into Victoria's presence. Such absurd posturing, Princess Leven referred to it as that German morgue and little-mindedness, gained nothing, and cost Victoria some of the respect she actually deserved. Adelaide gently chided the Duchess, and suggested none too subtly that Conroy was overreaching himself and ought to be kept in his place. King William, nervous and ill at ease in his role as ruler, took the demands and arch attitudes issuing from Kensington Palace badly, and became suspicious of Victoria as a result. When she attended her first chapter of the Order of the Garter, wearing a black gown with a hugely long train walking behind Adelaide, William squinted at her through her long black veil to see whether she looked any different. And when, early in 1831, the princess was present for the first time at a royal drawing room, no doubt filled with amazement at the grandeur around her and at the same time shy and painfully self-conscious, William again scrutinized her and did not like what he saw. Her gaze was stony, he said, when she turned it on him. He saw, or thought he saw, in that basilisk stare, the hardening influence of the strong-willed, self-regarding Duchess of Kent. In actuality, Victoria was seeking to hide her nervousness behind an expression of regal reserve, and her feelings toward her uncle the king were warm, if slightly wary. For King William, an odd, red-faced, blustering old fool, was a far different creature from his brother George. Where George had been unctuous and punctilious about etiquette, with perfect manners and a particularly gracious bow, William was brusque to the point of rudeness, informal to the point of vulgarity, coarse in manner, and careless of his person and habits. Visitors to William's court noticed with horrified amusement that the king had a way of wiping his bulbous red nose with his forefinger instead of using a scented silk handkerchief, as his predecessor would have done. This was but one of his many grotesque ways. He was inclined to be suspicious. He meddled ceaselessly with the trivia of palace affairs. He refused to surround himself with an appropriate barrier of social distance and insisted upon walking at large in the streets of London's West End, or inviting acquaintances to ride in his royal coach, or even opening the palace gardens to any and all of his subjects. King William was an anomaly in every sense. So unkingly a sovereign had not occupied the throne for centuries. Not since the time of James I, in fact, whose bawdy jokes and lewd merrymaking, he liked to drop his trousers to scandalize the well-behaved, had caused the prestige of the monarchy to plummet. Worst of all, and most unsettling to his niece Princess Victoria, King William tended to talk wildly and constantly, throwing his arms about in great agitation. Often irritated, he would suddenly become empurpled with rage, his wildness frightening the servants and court officials and leading them to speculate that he would soon sink into the madness that had afflicted his father. But the king's eruptions of garrulity always subsided eventually, and he was restored to his brash, thoughtless self, a self that at its best had an appealing side. To those who knew William's story, he was a sympathetic figure. The third son of King George and Queen Charlotte, he was never expected to reign, and was sent into the navy at a young age and left to his own devices. Believing himself unloved by his parents, who much preferred their two older sons, William developed into a rakehell who fought and drank and fornicated his way up through the ranks, leaving a trail of broken heads and wrecked brothels and inconvenient bastards wherever he went. "Oh, for England and the pretty girls of Westminster," was his inebriated creed occur, "at least to such as would not clap or pox me every time I fucked." William was not mean-spirited, merely uncontrolled. His careless hell-raising was thoughtless and childish, but he was never dissolute, and lacked the over-refined tastes of a voluptuary. Plain William liked plain food, and had no use for culture or elegance. Fine art he referred to as knick-knackery, and he hated gilded walls and marbled furnishings. It was just as well that William preferred simple living, for he never had much money. And what little he had went to support his numerous children, all of them illegitimate and most of them greedy and demanding. His 10 children by the comic actress Dorothy Jordan, known to London hostesses as Les Batards, were the most conspicuous of his progeny. They lived with him and off him. And when his funds failed, Mrs. Jordan's stage profits made up the difference. William's second illegitimate family was more obscure. In fact, its existence didn't become public knowledge until after the king's death. But a bastard son born while the young William was living in Hanover had been raised in his father's home and destined for a naval career. He died young, drowning off the African coast during the Napoleonic Wars. For 40 years and more, William lived his singular life. A king's son, yet disregarded by most of his relatives and considered an embarrassment by society. Nobody ever invited him into their house or thought it necessary to honor him with any mark of attention or respect, wrote the diarist Greville, who was in a position to know. Even after he became heir apparent on the death of his brother Frederick, William was not brought forward into the limelight. He was too strange, too loquacious, too liable to burst into apoplectic wrath to be lionized as Britain's future king. The only notoriety he received came not from his position in the succession, but from an unfortunate physical trait. He had a head that came nearly to a point and was ridiculed as coconut. By his side, the coconut had what a visitor from abroad called undoubtedly the plainest woman in her dominions. This was Queen Adelaide, who was 37 in 1830. King William was 65. Only the most sympathetic of her courtiers could bear to look for long at her poor, afflicted face, crusty with sores and blazing with red blotches. But those who did saw there a look of sorrow and an almost poetic melancholy. Adelaide was easily moved to tears, so tender was her nature. And though some saw only weakness and insecurity in her watering eyes, her doctor called her a poor wishy-washy thing, others thought she was merely acutely sensitive and that she possessed an exceptionally able mind. Adelaide was an excellent wife to William, tolerant and benevolent, willing to overlook his obstreperous outbursts and happy to share her home with his 10 children by Mrs. Jordan, children who were now well grown with children of their own. To her sorrow, she had no living children, her one baby daughter having died at the age of 4 months. The great event of 1831 was to be King William's coronation. And the London season that spring and early summer was unusually festive. Balls and fetes were held every night. Grand military reviews went on in Hyde Park, and the late-rising fashionable world attended elaborate breakfasts served in the open air at 6 o'clock in the evening. Paganini played at the Opera House. The theater season sparkled. And everyone who was anyone crowded into the salons and dining rooms of the London mansions, eager to see and to be seen, gratified that King George and his stale grandeur had been swept away and that a fresh new spirit prevailed. The new spirit was much in evidence in the planning of the coronation. King William, impatient with formality, had at first proposed eliminating the costly coronation ceremony entirely, substituting a brief oath-taking in the presence of Parliament. This was going too far. The Conservatives in William's government insisted that there be a traditional crowning ceremony, but with a minimum of fuss and expense. Preparations went forward with an intent to save cost. Participants in the festivities were told that they had to provide their own liveries, robes, and gowns. The customary banquet in Westminster Hall would not be held. Even the Queen economized by not ordering a new crown made for herself. Instead, she had some of her own jewels made into a crown, paying for the new setting out of her private income. King William seemed uneasy amid the excitement of the gala season. His gawky figure lost in the crowd of gaudy notables that so often surrounded him. He sat at a plain table and gazed out of the window at the Windsor Flower Garden, clearly worried about his responsibilities and unhappy to be burdened with them. He could not trust his ministers. Adelaide vexed him. His children hounded him with requests for money, titles, marks of distinction. And his annoying sister-in-law, the Duchess of Kent, was a constant and increasingly galling irritant. "She is the most restless, persevering, troublesome devil possible," wrote the M.P. Thomas Creevey, an observant if bilious diarist. She made frequent demands for alterations to her apartments at Kensington Palace, insisting that new furniture be provided, new rooms added, the entire suite enlarged. She wrote to the King himself, to his new Prime Minister, Lord Grey, Wellington's successor, and to the harassed officers of the Board of Works, whose nemesis she had quickly become, in a tone of injured dignity. When her requests were ignored, she sent Conroy, who was no doubt the instigator of many of the Duchess's demands, to the Board of Works in person to express her extreme dissatisfaction with the King and his Prime Minister. Like sandpaper, the Duchess's shrill requests, repeated almost daily, abraded what goodwill the King felt toward his heir and her self-important mother. William began to resent the sight of the dowdy Duchess, who was now present at all important court functions, dressed, observers thought, with a certain German homeliness, her face set in a rictus of determination. That the King and his minister were Tories, and the Duchess a staunch Whig, only made the situation worse, as did the rising tide of political dissent. The demand for democratic reform that seemed to advance as the new king's reign went along. To William, his sister-in-law was one more member of the opposition, albeit a particularly obstreperous one, nagging at him to take action he preferred not to take. "The squabbles that have been going on at Kensington Palace do not surprise me," Princess Leven wrote. In her view, it was inevitable that the confused, beleaguered king and the pushy duchess, pushed by Conroy, would clash resoundingly. "Those people are wrong-headed to the utmost possible degree," she added, meaning the duchess and Conroy, "which, however, is a great pity, for after all, the future of England is placed in their hands." Victoria was England's future. It was Victoria, Lady Wharncliffe thought when she saw her, who would save us from democracy, for it is impossible that she should not be popular when she is older and more seen. Lady Wharncliffe saw the princess from time to time at the Duchess's soirees and was delighted with her. "She is very much grown, though short for her age," she recorded, "has a nice countenance and distingué figure, though not very good, and her manner is the most perfect mixture of childishness and civility I ever saw." The princess was polite, natural, and unaffected. She spoke with charming grace of manner about her liking for music and her drawing lessons and her dolls. And when the evening was over, Lady Wharncliffe noted, she took leave of the company, who stood up out of respect for her, by kissing her Aunt Sophia, curtsying first to one side and then the other to all the ladies, and then walking off with Letson. Victoria was still Victoria, but only just. Ministers of the king, contemplating the future, thought seriously about changing her name to Charlotte. Charlotte had been the popular name of George IV's mourned daughter, dead for 15 years, but still remembered fondly and a bit tearfully by the English. Charlotte had been the name of Victoria's grandmother, George III's queen. Of unhappy memory, William IV said of his mother, "I only wish the accursed bitch would have spewed her soul up, and then we should have had some peace in the house." Charlotte was a good German name, while Victoria was neither English nor German, but French, and France was England's hereditary enemy. Victoria was also the name of the Duchess of Kent, and William was coming to despise it and her more every day. When it was announced to the Duchess that her daughter's name was to be changed, she was amenable, but before long she altered her view and became recalcitrant. Victoria herself, though grieved beyond measure at the thought of any change, said nothing. She was no longer rebellious, but indrawn, keeping her feelings, however strong, to herself. Time passed, another name was suggested, the name Elizabeth, and finally, 6 months after the original suggestion had been made, the plan was dropped, ostensibly because the English were accustomed to hearing the princess called Victoria and liked the name. The princess was greatly delighted, though the king was furious. As the day of the royal coronation approached, more imperious pronouncements issued from Kensington Palace. Victoria would assume the place of honor in the king's procession, the Duchess insisted. She would walk immediately behind His Majesty. The response from the king was negative. His brothers, Ernest and Augustus and Adolphus, would follow him. The princess would follow them. Vexed beyond measure, not only by King William's insult to his heir, but by his government's insultingly small increase in the Duchess's allowance, she decided to express her indignation in the strongest way she knew. She would remove Victoria from the coronation ceremony entirely. She wrote a letter to the king saying that the princess had fallen and injured her knee and could not attend. Then she took Victoria and the servants off to Norris Castle on the Isle of Wight, far from the noise and excitement of London, to wait until the festivities were over. The great day came, September 8, 1831. Trumpets blared, horses clopped down freshly swept streets, crowds gathered to cheer King Billy and to catch a glimpse of his peculiar head. Inside Westminster Abbey, its dim recesses brightened with the most economical velvets and laces and embroidered liveries that a stringent budget would allow, a hushed congregation watched the old king make his slow way down the aisle toward the throne. They took note of his very infirm walk, the way he wore his robes as though they were made of iron, the defeated slope of his shoulders, and his lowered head and furrowed brow. They looked in vain for the little 12-year-old princess and were dismayed by her absence. She, too, was dismayed, though she did her best to hide her feelings from her mother. She went down to the beach and walked in the sand, wading out into the icy water, looking down into the tide pools, watching the sunlight gleam across the choppy waters of the Solent. No one had consulted her about whether or not she wanted to attend her uncle's coronation. No one cared that she was so very disappointed not to be able to go. Her mother was angry at the king, he was very angry back, and would now be angry with Victoria, too. Everything would be worse than before. In her depressed state, Victoria got out her dolls and laid them out one by one, hoping that their familiar presence would comfort her. Instead of comfort, they deepened her distress. She wept inconsolably. For her situation, for her sorrow, for the fate that awaited her when on some future day she would herself become queen. Chapter 3. The London crowds that had cheered lustily for the king on his coronation day turned angry and rebellious when a month later the bill to reform Parliament was defeated in the House of Lords. Agitation for reform had become a national obsession. The old political order, in place for hundreds of years, vested political power in the hands of a tiny minority of wealthy and privileged families who controlled the government, the military, and the church. Advocates of change demanded a broadening of the franchise to include the more affluent middle classes and more equitable representation.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.